In your Bibles to the book of Luke, chapter number 2. Man, I am hoping that I can tie a couple of different thoughts here together and bring the Word of God home to us this evening. That's what it's about when you're, for me as a pastor, trying to bring that Word through the power of the Holy Ghost that will just encourage and strengthen. We've already had that tonight. Amen. We heard Sister Rachel testifying from the Word of God and tying in with what Sister Tina said this morning. And then to be able to hear what Brother David shared this evening. The Word of God, it's rich and good to us. And so let's take it. Let's apply it to our life. I'm glad that it's not just the pastor reading the Word of God and learning, studying, and sharing. I'm glad that we can come together as a body and we can each present what God has been working and doing in our life. So I want to look at two groups of people in Luke chapter number 2, that when I look at them, though they're some 20 verses apart from one another, when I look at them, who they are and their immediate activity challenges me in my everyday life. And so when you look at Luke chapter number 2, and really get started at verse number 15, where the angels give that herald to the shepherds there on the hillside that Jesus is born, the Messiah is come. Once that angelic presentation was given to them, the Bible says that they came with haste and they found Mary and Joseph, that baby, and they were lying in the manger. And when they had seen it, or better interpreted, him, they made known abroad the saying which was told them concerning the child. And when all they that heard it wondered at these things which were told them by the shepherds, Mary keeping all those things there in her heart and pondering them. Verse number 20 says, and when the shepherds returned, they glorified God, praising God for all the things that they had heard and seen as it was told unto them. There's a few things I want to look at here, and then I want to jump down a little bit later in Jesus' life. But the very first thing that I want to look at is that when we have an experience with Jesus, when we return from visiting the presence of God, whether that's praying ourselves on an everyday level, being the Word of God, or particularly as I look at tonight being at church, when we have that experience, that confirmation of faith, it will change our lives. Mm-hmm. Amen. Here it was. They saw Christ. They experienced great faith in Him. They knew the Messiah had come. They realized that heavenly introduction to Jesus Christ was God's message to them. Brother Doug, they went there. They found Mary and Joseph. But when they saw Jesus, that is who they longed to see and to be with. And the Bible says that when they saw Him, they returned. I know that there's times in our life, Brother David, when we see the presence of God, amen, we don't return to some things. Some things are sin. We don't go back to it. Amen. Let him that sins sin no more. Amen. There's a breach in sin. Sometimes, as the wise men were, their meeting with Christ, God directed them in a different path. However, we see these shepherds, as lowly as they may be, and in their position of every day taking care of the sheep, while everybody else slept, they were out on the hillside taking care of the sheep. And here it was, the Bible says, that when they saw Christ, amen, they weren't skeptical, but they had faith in Christ, that they returned. There was a confirmation of their faith. Amen. They returned. Amen. And then the Bible says that not only did they return, but they returned glorifying and praising God. Do you know what happens? The effects of having a relationship when we see Christ. we will glorify God.
Amen.
Tonight, it's not just about coming to church. Amen. It's not just about seeing those that we attend church with. Or it's about seeing Christ. Amen. Because God's word has commanded us, amen, to remember the Sabbath day and to keep it holy and to not forsake the assembly of ourselves. But we do it that we may view Christ. Amen. And there has to be faith in Christ. Amen. A belief that this is the Messiah. Amen. This is God Almighty. This is my Creator. Amen. This is my Sustainer. This is going to be the Redeemer of my soul. And so here they are. They have that confirmation of faith. But the conduct of faith was that they glorify and they praise God for what they had seen. Amen. Do you come tonight expecting to see Christ?
Amen.
Do you? Amen. I feel like we've already seen Him. As we were singing songs tonight, I felt the presence of God. There's a spirit of worship that's in the house. Amen. As folks testified, then as Brother David, you shared tonight, then as Brother Justin led us in prayer, I feel the presence of God. And I believe that in the Word of God tonight, that we'll sense and feel the Holy Ghost that we're already sensing in the service. Amen. And as we confirm our faith and the conduct of our faith is there, we are going to return either to our homes tonight, amen, or to our jobs tomorrow, and they may feel like just the shepherds returning to a lowly position. You ever feel that way? Amen. Here it is, Monday morning. Amen. It's back to work, back to the grind. Maybe not the job that you dreamed of, or maybe, but it's what God's provided, and maybe you're not where you want to be. Amen. But I believe this, that we as believers, amen, it's not sin to go back to our homes or to our families or to our jobs, amen, but there is something that we will experience when we've had a real encounter with Christ. Mm-hmm. Amen. We will take faith with us. We will take rejoicing and glorifying and praising God with us. We return to our duties, amen, but we return there glorifying and praising God. There's doxology in our heart. Amen. We worship. The thing that's different when we go back to our duties is still about God. It's about my experience with God. So, when you go home tonight, I want you to think about this, that I've just been with Christ. I've just worshiped the Savior. And so, though I may be returning to just the grind, I'm returning rejoicing and praising God. Well, I want that force. I want folks to say, but up on Hill Street, those folks are different all week long. Boy, when you talk to them, you never hear language that's not becoming of Christ. You never hear conversation that is not edifying. You never hear grumbling, complaining, constantly wrong. But they're talking about their relationship with having visited with Christ.
Mm-hmm.
That's what it's about tonight, folks. Amen. And the shepherds return, glorifying and praising God for all the things that they had heard and seen as it was told to them. So I'll ask Brother Saville to refresh what's happened in our week as we talk about prayer. Brother Walt and Sister Beverly here this morning, visiting with her mom this week. Amen. And hearing throughout the past week of her progress and not knowing what was going on last Sunday, so alarmed by what her symptoms betray. Amen. But now seeing this week that God's touched her body. Amen. Why do I share that? Because God's heard prayer. Amen. We've seen God work. So now we return to our week and we share what God has done. Amen. We've heard about Heather that we didn't know 3 weeks ago would she even live a couple days. When we heard about surgeries and we still don't know the outcomes, and when the prognosis just is, well, it's just not great. But now we hear her shaking her head yes to questions. Let me tell you what, God is doing something there. So why do we rehearse that in the ears of believers? Because when we return to the grind of things, when we're back taking care of the sheep and the night is and everybody else is sleeping, Brother David, we can still rejoice because we've met with God and seen the wonders of God.
Amen.
Amen. So the shepherds knew that they were going to leave Christ. But knowing they left him with Mary and Joseph, they left with a relationship in their heart. Jumping down a few more verses. Verse number 41. The Bible talks about this young boy. 12 years has passed. It's only a few verses. But Brother David, 12 years have passed in these verses. The Bible says that now his parents, speaking of Jesus, went to Jerusalem as they did every year for the feast of Passover. They were godly people. They were righteous people. They were doing what was required of them. They were celebrating the Passover. But they even understand and know that they were celebrating what their son would do for all the world. What gift God had sent to them, Brother Doug. Here they are in the middle of celebration. It's been 12 years, Sister Beth, that they've been doing that. Jesus was used to it. And so as they go to Jerusalem, they went up to Jerusalem. And the days were fulfilled. There was probably 7 days here. They were celebrating 3 feasts, which would be the Feast of Passover, the Feast of Unleavened Bread, and the Feast of First Fruit. The Bible says that here they are probably for a week celebrating these feasts. And they were on their way from Jerusalem to go to Nazareth. And the Bible says the child Jesus tarried behind. Now he was 12 years at the age, so there's a lot of things that we need to take into consideration. But Brother Craig, at this time in his life, he is treated as though he is an adult. In the Jewish customs and cultures, he's an adult, so they're treating him as so. And they are traveling back to Nazareth, and Mary and Joseph, they didn't realize that Jesus wasn't with them. They're traveling in a group of people. Could it be that he's not traveling with their group, but maybe another group, maybe some friends, some family? He is old enough now that by their culture and customs, that this is acceptable. Wasn't that they're simply being negligent of their 12-year-old child? And so the Bible says that they did not know that he wasn't with them. But supposing him to have been in the company, they go a day's journey. And they sought him among their kinfolks and acquaintance. And when they found him not, they turned back again to Jerusalem, seeking him. The Bible says that after 3 days, they found him in the temple. They lost some days, a day's journey, a day's back, and now 3 days looking for him. So 5 days, it's pretty rigorous. Could you imagine that? I'll tell you straight up, I would be in panic mode. I would have called every police officer that I knew and every individual, and we'd be searching very, very hard to find. And so here it is that they're searching for Jesus. And the very first thing that I want us to notice is, yes, these shepherds, they had an experience with Christ. Their faith caused them to go back to their everyday routine and rejoicing and worshiping. But now we find that Mary and Joseph, in this same chapter, they kind of become accustomed to Jesus. And they know that there's good folks around, and they're expecting him to travel with Jesus to travel with them. And so as they go a day's journey, they don't think much about it because it's just casual. It's everyday to them. But after a day's journey, they realize that he is not there. If we're not careful, it won't be like the first experience where we met Jesus, where faith abounds, where we're, Sister Deb, where we're so excited that we rejoice, but it becomes every day to us. And so we do what we did the past 12 years, and we went to Passover, we've celebrated, we're on our way back home. There's things to get to back home. So a day's journey, There they are, running behind, but they find that they're without Christ. Let's stop for a minute. That has potential to be really hard. Doing what we know is right. Godly people, good people, doing what we know is righteous. But sometimes getting so busy in the middle of life that we've left Jesus behind. The shepherds left him behind physically, but they did not leave him behind emotionally or spiritually. They had him. And here's Mary and Joseph. They've forgotten about him today. They're good people. They don't mean it harm. They don't mean bad. They just simply have forgot about Jesus. And they find out one day too late that they were without Christ. Mm-hmm. What is that like, Brother Justin, if we're so busy in our life and we find out one day too late that we've just moved too early and we've moved without Christ? It wasn't that we meant to. It wasn't that we intentionally did it. We thought he was there. We thought he was in our company. But we left him because we just were not very intentional about doing it. Listen, we can't leave the things of God here in this church tonight. But they got to go home with us to our houses. And then they have to go to our jobs. And they have to go with us to our lonely places. And even though we may have been gone and we have all kinds of things stacked up and we're busy, it doesn't matter. We need Christ. Mm-hmm. So the realization that they are without Christ, the realization of Christ's absence, and then the result of that is they went a day's journey without him, and then they had to seek to find him. There's a few things that I know is here. You know, I'm not a math genius, but I know it took them a day's journey, so it takes them a day back. And the Bible says that they searched for him 3 days. Now, if I had all those things up, it's 5 days. 5 days. Can you imagine how much that has just interfered with the lack of progress that they really do want? Man, they need to be back home in Nazareth. There's things that they need to do. Joseph's a carpenter. He's getting behind on schedule. Maybe they have someone in charge of the dock. I don't know. I'm just saying things in everyday vernacular of life. Now what they had planned for has become more eventful than what they ever expected because now they're 5 days behind. You know what happens when we begin to move without realizing that Christ is not with us? It will cause a lack in our progress. We want to be somewhere. We want to do something. We have great expectations. But when we move without Christ, it causes us a hindrance and a lack in our progress. Mm-hmm. The Bible says that in verse number 48, and when they saw him, they were amazed. And his mother said unto him, why have you dealt with us? Because behold, your father and I sought you sorrowfully. Not only does it cause us a lack in progress, but it causes us a lack of pleasure. Look, God intended for our life to be lived intentionally, redeeming the time. And God intends for our life to be full of His pleasure. I love what Sister Rachel said this morning. Listen, I'm not even going to try to imagine what it would be like to see my child in a hospital bed and to get that phone call that your child has just been in an accident. Could you come identify her? You know, really, I don't know, Brother Doug. I can imagine, I can empathize, but I don't know. I've never been there. But one thing she said, she told me even after church when I was talking to her, she doesn't mind sharing. She said, usually I hold it together in front of some people, but when I'm with those personal people, I lose it. She said, but my experience has not been this way. You know why? Because Christ is in the church. How can we have pleasure when things go wrong? When the unforeseen happens and we don't like it? You know why, Sister Nancy? Because we've not forgotten about Jesus. Amen. We've not had a lack in our progress, and we've not had a lack of pleasure. Listen, I'm not sorrowing because I've left Jesus somewhere, amen, behind because I was too busy moving on. Amen. I'm not sorrowing, but I have pleasure in the things of this life. Amen. Because Christ is with me. Amen. Thank God tonight that we can have the confidence no matter where we are. Amen. There's no lack in our progress, and there's no lack in our pleasure because Christ is with us. Amen. Would you grab hold of Him tonight and know that after you leave here, you can leave with faith and rejoicing because He goes with you. Mm-hmm. You've not left Him behind. There's some reasons for Christ's absence. You know, the Bible says that they were supposing Him to have been in their company. They may be traveling with some other folks. See, but Jesus tarried. If Joseph and Mary had been in the right place, they would have tarried as well. We live in a very fast-paced world. Probably greater than we've ever lived before. I mean, we are so networked on a social level that when something happens in another country, at the push of a button, it is a newsflash to everybody here in the States that know them. Social media has, there's nothing left unsaid. I mean, we live in such a way that our food is prepared so fast because we lack that instant gratification. We're so busy. And we live in the day of microwaves and, you know, just everything. You know what I'm talking about. I mean, our jobs, we want faster service and everything's meant to be faster. We live in a fast-paced world. And you know, we come to that place where we think that when the needle of the clock hits this time, that I need to be somewhere else. And sometimes God's saying, listen, would you just hear me with me? Mm-hmm. Mary and Joseph, they were too much in a hurry. They didn't know where Jesus was. Had they spoke to Him? Had they sought Him out? They would have known. How is your life? How is my life? Are we too much in a hurry that causes us lack in progress and causes us lack in our pleasure? And then I think about the cares. You know, so they were so occupied with the cares of life, they needed to get home. It was probably legitimate things they needed to do. Listen, you know what it's like when you're away from your home for a week? You need to get back home and take care of things. You know, things in your yard, things in your house. You know, all those things need to be taken care of. So the cares. But not only the cares, but they were careless. And I said, Pastor, how do you say that? They were careless because they were supposing Him to be in the congregation that was traveling. But they did not know. How are we? Are we careless? Is God involved in the things of our life? Have we talked to Him? This morning I tried to talk so broad spectrum, but nail it down as tight as I could about relationships and love. Have we talked to God about all those relationships that are in our life? Have we talked to God about the well-being of our soul? Have we talked to God about the direction of our life and the decisions? Have we invited God into our finances? Have we invited God into our health? You see, sometimes we suppose, well, God knows. He does know. But He stands at the door knocking. And if any man will hear Him, would you open up the door and let Him come in and sup with you? Have you prayed about the situation? that is currently on your radar? Or have you just supposed that Christ is at it? I'm talking tonight about meeting with Christ and leaving rejoicing because of the effects of sin. A faith that causes us, when we go back to the lowly of life, that causes us to go back with a song and with hope and with faith. I'm talking tonight to a band of believers. Listen, you folks that are here tonight, every one of you, you didn't just get saved yesterday or last week or a month ago. You've been serving God for some time. But we can be like Mary and Joseph, supposing when all the time Christ has said, "Tarry." Tonight, if Sister Beth would come to the piano, I just want to ask you one question. Do you know where Jesus is? Is he with you? Or are you just supposing that in those decisions and in those plans you made, Christ is there? Or do you know for certain he is traveling in your journey? If you don't know he's there, two things I want to remind you. It's a lack of progress for you if he's not there. You'll waste time going back and finding him. Not that it's ever a waste of time. If you've lost him, go back. But if you're about to move and he's not ready to move, stay. And if Christ has not moved in those areas of your life that you're moving in, stay. Because there'll be a lack of pleasure. You may say, "Brother Saville, but I'm concerned about the cares." I appreciate your cares. But in taking care of the cares, don't become careless. Christ wants to move with you. Tonight, I want us to gather in. Let's spend a season in prayer, knowing that we know where Christ is and we are moving with him. Would you come find a place of prayer tonight? Amen. Allow the cares of life to be taken care of, but make sure you're not careless. Move with Christ that he may give you progress and pleasure.